So good evening, everyone. It's a real pleasure and honor to discuss with you tonight some new approach for the LUTS management due to BPH. We know that during this webinar, you will be able to ask me questions through the system. So really feel free to ask any question you want about these topics, and I will be happy to discuss with you through this website about the question you have. So I will start now the course. So we'll have a course for 30 minutes, and then we'll have some questions for 15 to 20 minutes, depending to you. I'm very happy to be with you tonight, and we are going to discuss so this LUTS management due to BPH. Of course, as you know, there is a lot of different cause of LUTS. Of course, there is a benign prostatic obstruction, overactivity of bladder, but we have also a lot of different causes that can induce some LUTS, and of course, those are your patient. And we have to know all of these causes in order to give the good treatment to the good patient and to improve his quality of life, because this is the main goal when we have to deal with LUTS. It's not going to increase the life expectancy, because we know that it's a benign disease, but the goal is to improve the quality of life. So tonight we are going, of course, to discuss some aspect of the treatment of BPH. We are going, of course, to talk about surgery, because we are surgeons as urologists, but we have also a physician, and we have to give drugs, and there is some issues that I want to discuss with you tonight. The first one is the combination therapy. What do we have to prescribe? What is recommended? And what is the real life practice? And see how we can manage that. And on surgery, I put three different things. Minimally invasive surgery, is it the new standard? Can we reduce the LUTS due to BPH with a prostatic artery embolization or revascularisation of the pelvic artery? And last point, how to deal with persistent LUTS due to this BPH and after a BPH surgery. So in terms of combination therapy, I will start with this very interesting study. This came from the group of Lukacs in Paris, and they have access to the different database from the different insurance companies. And they are able to follow the patient through this, this system, and this system registers all surgery, medication, anything that needs the patient during his life, and especially for his health. So he focused on patients who received, as you can see, some medication for BPH, and he was able to distinguish the prescription performed by the general practitioner and the prescription performed by the urologist. And then if you look at the data, of course it's not recent data, it was in 2004, but they continue to follow the patients. This is the reason why this is the data at the inclusion. And you see that if we look at the prescription as the initiation of treatment of these French people, you see that monotherapy is present in 94% of the case for the GP and 92% for urologist. You can see that some of the patients receive B therapy, so combination therapy, 5.8% for the general practitioner, 7.8% for urologist. And you see that minority, but still, there is some people who will receive three different therapies for BPH, and it's 0.1%, but still, there is some people who use this kind of approach and have some this kind of approach. When we look at the detail and look at what type of combination therapy the patient receive, you see that in 50% of the case, for the prescription performed by urologists, it's a combination of alpha blocker and 5-alpha reductase inhibitors. That is the only one combination therapy that is recommended by EAU. There is 28% of prescriptions of this combination performed by the GP. And very interestingly, there is some combination therapy that are not really recommended, and we're going to go through that. It's a combination of alpha blocker and phytotherapy. You see that this represents 65% of the prescription of B therapy performed by the GP and 46% performed by urologist. And you have also thiophoreductase inhibitor and phytotherapy in 5% and 3% respectively for a GP and urologist. Definitely, if you look at the recommendation, and I told you that there is only one or two combination therapies that are recommended. The first one is alpha blocker and thiophoreductase inhibitor, and the second is the association of alpha blocker and a muscarinic agent. We are going to see that. But if we want to look at the association of phytotherapy and alpha blocker, in the literature, there is no recommendation, first of all. And second thing, there is only one study who looked at this association. This was performed a long time ago, 2002. They randomized 392 patients into groups. First group who will receive tamsulosin and the other group who will receive tamsulosin and seranoprazole. And you see clearly on this curve that in terms of IPSS, there is no advantage of using both therapies. So clearly, we have to change our practice. We have to teach, of course, the GP to do a good combination therapy, but we have also to discuss with urologists because we are not doing a good thing when we use this kind of association. When we look at the thiophoreductase inhibitor, we have first to think about the delay of efficacy of this drug to our patients. Usually, when you start a thiophoreductase inhibitor, it takes 6 months to 1 year to have an improvement in terms of reduction of the LUTS. And this is the reason why, at the beginning, the pharmaceutical company who produced the thiophoreductase inhibitors, and at the beginning it was the MSD, they started to think about an association of alpha blocker plus thiophoreductase inhibitor in order to have rapid improvement in terms of LUTS with the alpha blocker. And then, after that, they will continue only with the 5-alpha-reductase inhibitors to have a long-term efficacy of this drug. So we know that the 5-alpha-reductase inhibitor, as I mentioned, need 6 to 12 months to be very effective. With this drug, you have a prostate volume reduction by 15 to 25%. And of course, we know that when you have to follow the PSA, this PSA will increase by 50% after 6 months. There is a lot of different prospective randomized trials looking at thiophoreductase inhibitor for our patient. And as you can see, if we look at the EU guideline recommendation, thiophoreductase inhibitors can be offered to men who have moderate to severe LUTS and an enlarged prostate, more than 40 milliliters. And this medication can prevent disease progression with regard to acute urinary retention or need of surgery. First study looking at the association of finasteride and doxazosine, it was a PREDICT trial. PREDICT trial had a short follow-up of 1 year. And you see, I put this on the result of the MTOP study, that is exactly the same design than PREDICT, but with a very long follow-up. And the conclusion of the PREDICT trial was that finasteride was very close in terms of efficacy to placebo. So, of course, you imagine that the pharmaceutical company was not very happy at this stage because they had the feeling that their drugs are not working very well. Of course, we know now that to have a good efficacy of this drug, we need to treat the patient at least 1 year. So, very important trial looking at the combination. It's an MTOP study. They randomized patients in four groups, placebo, finasteride, doxazosine, and combination therapy. And you see clearly that in terms of risk of BPH progression, there is an advantage of giving to the patient the two drugs, finasteride and doxazosine. So what is the definition of the BPH progression? It's an increase of 4 points of AUI symptom score, that is close to the IPSS, an acute urinary retention, infection, or renal failure. But clearly, when we look at the different events that cause this BPH progression, so the increase of 4 points in AUI symptom score was the most important. For dutasteride, of course, GSK produced the same trial, and again, they found that when you use a combination of dutasteride and tamsulosin, you have clearly good efficacy in terms of APSS, in terms of improvement of quality of life, and also in terms of reduction of risk of acute urinary retention, and need of surgery, and so on. So clearly, if you want to have a scientific proof of this combination therapy, you have in front of you the most clear data that we can have concerning the combination therapy. So what is the group of patients who really need this kind of approach? It's for patients who have a large prostate, greater than 40 gram. You need to treat the patient for at least 1 year. You have to discuss, of course, the side effect, because when you go for a combination, you are going to increase the side effect. And the question is, do we have to continue after 6 months, 6 years, and you see that for EU guideline, it can be in discussion. So clearly, if you want to have a recommendation, you can look at the EU guideline, and EU guideline tells you that combination treatment with alpha blocker and thyroglobulinase inhibitor can be offered to men with moderate to severe LUTS, with large prostate, and who have a reduced of Qmax. Concerning this combination therapy, I have 2 points to mention tonight in order perhaps to create some discussion with you. First of all, the side effect. You know that you have side effect due to a certain drug. For instance, you have the effect on hypotension with doxazosine that you don't have with the finasteride. You have here this table here. And you know also that with finasteride, you have some side effect in terms of erectile dysfunction, in terms of libido, that you don't have with doxazosine, but with doxazosine, you have also the reduction of production of sperm. So when you go for a combination therapy, you accumulate the side effect, and this really has to be discussed with the patient. The second point, it's a provocative point, it's when you want to look clearly at the improvements that you can have in terms improvement in IPSS when you compare patient who receive combination versus patient who receive, for instance, only a dutasteride. And you see the difference is here. At 2 years, there's only 1.3 points in difference in terms of IPSS. And you have to know that if the patient is going to report a difference in terms of improvement of quality of life when there is at least 3 points in difference in the IPSS. So you need to have an improvement of at least 3 points in IPSS to have the patient who feel better. So do we have that for all operation? Probably not. We need to go for more study, more analysis of this top study and the trial from GSK to perhaps to have a group of patients who really have a good answer to this combination therapy, because when you look overall, you have an improvement in terms of reduction of the IPSF of 1.3 points. And this is not clinically significant for me. Combination of alpha blocker and anti-muscarinic drug. Again, in literature, there is a lot of different trials. A lot of them say that is effective. Do we have to start immediately with this combination? Probably not. We have to start first with an alpha blocker or perhaps an antihistaminic alone, and if needed, we can combine them, and in this case, you can have a better improvement of your LUTS. Very important is, do we increase the risk of acute urinary retention when you use anti-muscarinic drug in BPH patients? The answer is probably not. If you evaluate correctly your patient at baseline, so you have to include patients who have a PVR greater than 200 milliliters or patients who have very, very low Qmax, less than 5, less than 4 milliliters per second. This kind of patient has really a high risk of developing acute urinary retention when you use the anti-muscarinic drug. So what EU guideline tell you concerning this association? This association, so a combination treatment with an alpha blocker together with a muscarinic receptor antagonist may be used in patients with bothersome, moderate to severe LUTS, if relief of storage symptoms has been insufficient with a monotherapy with either drug. Okay, so you have some predominance of storage symptoms, You can start with an alpha blocker or with anti-muscarinic, and then if it's not enough, you can go for a combination therapy. Another association that was reported in the literature is the association of PDE5 inhibitor and alpha blocker, and you see that in terms of reduction of the IPSS or improvement of Qmax, there is a benefit for the patient to have this kind of association. Another association that is in the literature is associated with FAR-related inhibitor and PDE5 inhibitors, and you can see that in this case you have improvement of course of the sexuality, and you have also slightly better improvement in terms of IPSS when you give these two drugs. This has to be discussed with the patient. So if you really want to discuss combination therapy with your patient, you have to go for combination therapy for a certain group of patients. If you look at the decision tree of EAU, you see that you have the indication of association of treatment, mostly fibrator rector inhibitor and alpha blocker, and in this group of patients, so it's for patients who have large prostate, greater than 40 milliliters, and who are going for a long-term treatment. And in this group, you can go for this kind of combination. Be careful with the combination therapy because you increase the cost. You are going to decrease the observance. We know that when you give more drug to a patient, the patient is going to not to take all of them. And you are going also to increase the side effects. What about the minimally invasive surgical treatment? Is it really a new gold standard? Probably yes. When I mean when I discuss this minimally invasive treatment, I think about laser. Laser therapy is dramatically increasing in our daily practice. You have here an analysis from a Canadian group who shows that clearly there is an increase of procedure performed with a laser, and laser is redeveloped in hot clinic patients now. So clearly we have to look at what we can get for a patient from this this kind of device, because if you look this kind of approach, because if you look at the EU guideline, you see that laser is everywhere for patients with a prostate between 30 and 80 milliliter. You have of course a TURP, but of course you can see that there is laser enucleation, laser vaporization. If you look at big prostate greater than 80 milliliter, again you see that you have the OLEP. You have the laser vaporization. If you have patient under anticoagulant or antiplatelet therapy, you see that you can go for laser or laser vaporization or laser enucleation. So clearly, you see that there is a spread of this laser therapy in the recommendation and of course for our patients. So laser in urology, it's a very long story. It started in 1984 with the laser was used for the treatment of prostate carcinoma. And then in 1992, there is an incision of the prostate performed in dogs. 1993, they started the treatment of BPH in 27 patients with this NDAC laser. And it took in 2004, the Cochrane review concluded that laser techniques are a useful alternative to TURP for the treatment of prostate enlargement. We have to be aware that laser and lasers are not the same. You have this nice picture from all the Star Wars persons with different type of laser, but it's going to be the same thing for you in the OR. You have to be aware about the different lasers that you can have. The first is, of course, the PVP, that is well known, the green light laser that is here on this figure, and you see that the depth of absorption is around 1 millimeter. You have the second one that I want to discuss with you is an NYAG laser that is clearly not recommended because the depth of absorption is very large, more than 1 centimeter. So you can do some damage that you are not going to see. So clearly this is not for BPH treatment. You have the onium with a depth of absorption of 0.4 millimeter, and you have the thulium laser with a depth of absorption of 0.4 milliliter. So in the different meeting and when you discuss with a different company, you will see that you have a lot of different devices and different machine for the laser. You have the green light laser with which you can, of course, do vaporization, but you can do also incision of the prostate with this machine. You can do enucleation of the prostate. This is a green light. You have the holmium luminous with which you can do whatever you want. It was developed mostly for doing enucleation, but you can do also vaporization, resection of incision of the prostate, and same thing for the thulium. You can do whatever you want, just a question of practice. So what do we have in the literature concerning the prostate vaporization and the TURP? Well, this nice study published last year, the Goliath study, it's a prospective randomized trial looking at the efficacy of green light laser 180 watts compared to the TURP. And this randomized trial was performed in 11 countries and include 291 patients. They look at the follow-up at 12 months, and clearly you have on this table the functional outcome. You see that the IPS at 1 year with green light is 7 compared to what they obtained with the TURP, 5.7, so no difference. The Qmax, 23 milliliters per single for green light, 24 for TURP, again, no difference. And in terms of complication, it's exactly the same. So the conclusion of this study is that the green light is not inferior to TURP throughout the treatment of all patients. So what is the advantage of the laser therapy? It's probably because you have less bleeding, you are going to have a short duration of the catheterismus, you have a short duration of the hospitalization, and you have less bleeding complication. So in terms of other complications that we can have with this kind of surgery, you see that clearly there is no difference between TURP and green light therapy for bladder neck stricture, incontinence, or impact on the sexual function. Important thing, there is a certain learning curve. At the beginning, it's, I will say, funny to use this green light laser because you see rapidly the effect on the prostate tissue, and you have the feeling that it's very easy to do this surgery. But clearly, there is a learning curve. This is a nice study from Vincent Israel in Toulouse in France, who looked at the first 50 cases that he did with green light 180 and compared to the last 50 cases that he performed, and see that there is no difference in terms of complication. This is important because it means that this technique is safe. But clearly, there is a difference in terms of prostate residual volume. It's not the same, higher for the first cases compared to the last cases that he performed. So clearly, there is a learning curve, and he said in the article that he believes that the learning curve of this green light vaporization is between 15 and 20 cases. Important point, anticoagulation and antiaggregant and laser treatment. Of course, when you believe in laser, you will have this kind of feeling that when you use laser, you have very clear urine at the end of the surgery compared to, of course, TURP with this kind of color that you have in urine, so really bloody urine. So this is a question that we have all the time between the people who really do only laser and believe that laser is the only way to treat BPH. So if you look at the EU guideline, you see that laser vaporization should be considered in receiving anticoagulant medication or with a high risk of cardiovascular risk. So I want to mention this study again to have a discussion with you probably at the end of the courses to mention that you have to be careful because all of the different studies looking at anticoagulation and antiaggregant therapy are probably close to what I mentioned today. So this is a retrospective analysis published this year in Urology. 384 patients treated with green light laser 180 gram in US and in Switzerland. And you see that 38% of the patients received before the therapy aspirin, 9% received clopidogrel, and 14% received warfarin. And if you look at the result and the conclusion of the study, they said that there is no difference in terms of postoperative complication for patients who receive anticoagulation, 13% of complication compared to patients who did not receive anticoagulant therapy, 11%. If you look at the 30 days of complication, it's almost the same. 5% for patients who receive anticoagulation and 8% for patients who did not receive anticoagulation. So if you look at this table, you say, okay, I go for anticoagulation. I go for laser therapy for my patient under anticoagulation, and I just continue the anticoagulation medication. Be careful. Look at the article. Aspirin, it's continued. We know, and for the different kind of surgeries that we perform, that we can continue aspirin for all of our patients, and there is not high risk of having complication with that. If you look at patients who receive clopidogrel, you see that the patient stopped the clopidogrel 3 to 7 days before the surgery, and they restart at day one. And for patients under warfarin, there is 61% of patients who continue this kind of medication. So clearly, of course, this kind of this kind of treatment that can be continued for the crane-like vaporization, but you see that most of the patients stop the kind of medication except the aspirin, but we know that it's not a big impact. But for the other one, you see that the urologists are very careful, and if you can stop the anticoagulation, please do it because you are going to have less complication after that. One point concerning the laser enucleation, that is for me clearly the future for the treatment of BPH. Why? Because we know that OLEP is almost the same than an open prostatectomy. And again, with an open prostatectomy, you have the lowest rate of retreatment after the surgery. And this is very important. This is what I teach every day to my resident. I say, you put a patient in the OR, it has to be once in his life, and you don't have to repeat the same treatment 5 years or 10 years after. And again, in this nice study from the group of Lucas with his analysis of the data coming from the health insurance, you see that the patient who had open prostatectomy has the lowest rate of retreatment at 5 years. And again, and this is known also in the literature, clearly open prostatectomy is the main and the best option to reduce the risk of retreatment. So what do we have in the literature? There is a lot of prospective randomized trial looking at OLEP versus TURP or OLEP and open prostatectomy. And if you look at the prospective randomized trial, looking at the OLEP versus open, you see that in terms of symptoms and QMAT is completely similar in terms of outcome. But when you look at OLEP versus TURP, OLEP is better for symptom improvement, for catheterization, and for QMAX. So clearly, TURP is good, but OLEP is much better. In terms of safety, again, we know that it's probably the same when you have a patient treated with OLEP compared to open prostatectomy or TURP. So EU guideline really mentioned that OLEP has a long-term functional result comparable to TURP and of course to open prostatectomy. So this is clearly something we have to work on, and clearly for me it's the future of the treatment of BPH enlargement. One point concerning, it's going to be a debate, one point concerning the embolisation or the revascularization of the prostate artery. So I will start with the revascularization of the prostate artery. This is an important study from Taiwan. They look at a certain approach in order to increase the blood supply of your prostate by putting some small stent in very distal artery. And we know that the vascular surgeon and also the radiologists are able to go very deep and very small artery, and they are able to put a stent or to put some beads in order either to revascularize an artery or to close an artery. And this study looked at people who had BPH enlargement and LUTS due to this BPH enlargement, and they put some stent. And what they observe is that you have an improvement in terms of PSS of 4.3 points. This is mostly what you have with the medication. And of course, you have also an improvement of in erectile function score. And this is interesting because it has to remember, you have to, and I'm sure you know the result of this tadalafil study compared to tamsulosin medication. And they found that, of course, you improve the IPSS score by 4 points, but also you improve the rectal function. So perhaps in the future, we'll be able to offer to all patients to put a stent in this prostatic artery in order to improve sexuality and urinary symptoms. But the problem is that you have some colleagues who developed the embolization of the prostatic artery. And you have in the literature 20 articles on that. And you have to be aware that only three came from urology department, the other came from the radiology department. So really, as urologists, we have to keep that in our hand and we have to discuss with the patient the indication of the embolization. So this is some one study published in 2014 comparing embolization versus TURP, and you see that in terms of IPSS, quality of score, and so on, you have exactly the same result in these two groups of patients. So if you look at the meta-analysis, there is two meta-analyses published in the literature, and both of them say that there is something behind this embolization of the prostate. You can improve the IPSS, you can improve the quality of life. It's a promising procedure, but we have to be careful because there is some side effect due to this ischemia. For instance, there is in the NICE guideline a report of necrosis of the bladder due to this embolization. So we have to discuss with that with the patient. So we have to discuss the side effect with the patient, and we have to say to a patient that it's a promising approach, but it has to be performed in prospective randomized trial in order to get a good evaluation of that. Last point, it's how to deal with persons' LUTS after surgery. Again, it's I would say not a common situation, but it can be present in one sort of all patients. Again, this LUCA group with this huge cohort of patients were able to detect patients who had surgery and see after that if they receive any kind of medication. And you see that at 6 months, 4 months, I'm sorry, 6% of them receive one of these drugs for BPH. And there is also 4% who receive an anti-myosinic drug. And if you look at 5 years after surgery, you see that 25% of all patients restarted a treatment either by plantar strike, 5-alpha inhibitor, alpha blocker for this kind of LUTS. And 14% of them restarted an anti-myosinic drugs. Why do they have to restart a treatment? Well, when you look at the IPSS of this patient and the border sub of this patient, you see that in 68% it's due to a nocturia that is not really linked with always with BPH enlargement. Sometimes it's the other disease and also the age that increase the nocturia. There is some urgency in 52% of the cases, and there is frequency in 40%. So you see that clearly there is again some LUTS after surgery, and we have to detect them. So we have to follow the patient, we have to discuss with the patient, and sometimes we have to restart the treatment or to withdraw a surgery. So as a conclusion of this talk, persistence of surgery is sometimes due to a false evaluation, a bad evaluation of the patient before the surgery. For instance, we go for surgery for a patient who are nocturia just because due to his age he produces more urine in the night. And also there is other cause that we have to evaluate, and especially the detrusor overactivity, for which of course surgery can help, but not always. So in conclusion, concerning this talk, I will say, first of all, combination therapy, yes, it's possible, but you increase the cost, side effects, and observance of the treatment, and you have clearly to follow the recommendation. And again, there is only one very well-recommended association. It's the alpha reactive inhibitor and alpha blocker. There is a second association that is not in the first line treatment, but probably in the second line treatment is the association of alpha blocker and anti-myosinic drug. The other one, there is no recommendation. Laser and anticoagulation, first of all, enucleation is for me the future of the treatment of BPH enlargement. For the patient under anticoagulant or anticoagulant, start when you start to use this kind of approach with easy case, and after that go for this patient to have high risk of of cardiovascular disease, and we need anticoagulant and antiaggregant, and you have to discuss with anesthesiologist if you have to stop, if you can stop the anticoagulant. Antiaggregant, again, it's really not a big problem. Embolisation, we have to be aware about this approach. We have to keep an eye on what's going on, especially sometimes because the radiologists do something just in their department and you are not aware about that. We have to discuss with them because the indication of embolization, and perhaps in the future the discussion between embolization or revascularization of the prostatic artery. Concerning the residual LUTS, again, it depends on your primary evaluation and to have a good indication of the surgery in order to reduce this problem of residual LUTS or recurrence of LUTS after surgery. So this is what I wanted to discuss with you during this 30-minute courses. And now I'm going to look at the different questions that you send to the system. Can we discuss that? For first question concerning the phytotherapy, can you explain what is phytotherapy? So phytotherapy is this plant extract that we have on the market, either with Serenaria plans or Pygium africanum. Second question is, are the goal to combine 5 alpha witness inhibitor and alpha blocker? Also, so it's combination of three drugs. Is there an indication of combination of 5 alpha witness inhibitor, alpha blocker, and anti-muscarinic at the same time? The answer is perhaps. We have to discuss that with the patient, but when you have to start three different drugs to treat a prostate enlargement, perhaps you have to discuss with the patient a surgery. And after that, perhaps you will have to continue the anti-muscarinic drug if the patient is very irritative, but at least you will reduce the obstruction and you can exclude from the treatment of your patient the 5-alpha-rectal inhibitor and the alpha blocker. Do we need a urodynamics exam before using the anti-muscarinic drug? In the daily practice, not, except the patient to have a neurological disease, for who, of course, you need a urodynamic evaluation. If you have some symptom of irritative, you have first you have to exclude the cause of this urgency. And you have to do a cystoscopy, cytology, in order to exclude a bladder a stone in the bladder, to exclude a bladder tumor, and you have also to discuss with the patient if he doesn't have a neurological disorders. So this is a special group of patients. So clearly, as urologists, we have to do some evaluation of these irritative symptoms in order to exclude bladder tumor and stone. And after that, we can go for this kind of medication. If there is a long-term patient who receive alpha blocker and 5-alpha inhibitor and start to complain about ED, what do you add in? Do you add a third medication? First, I discuss with the patient. I try to stop the 5-alpha inhibitors because we know that this medication can decrease the libido and decrease the erection. So this is the first point. I will go, of course, for PDE5 inhibitors because it's a good indication in order to improve his sexuality, but also to improve his LUTS. If a patient has alpha blocker and 5-alpha inhibitors therapy and improve, what is the plan? Do we have to continue the treatment or can we stop one of it? We know that if you want to have a good impact on the long term, on BPH progression, the most important drug is the alpha reductase inhibitors. So if you have to stop one drug, it's going to be the alpha blocker. What about the botulinic agent injection in LUTS? You have a very important publication that was very important article published last year, which shows that there is no impact on LUTS. So the Allergan, the pharmaceutical company, stopped to developing this kind of approach for BPH. Please, how do you manage bladder overactivity after LUTS surgery? Of course, overactivity after a BPH surgery, it's one of the problems. We can start with the anti-myosinic drug. If it's not enough, I will go for urodynamics and perhaps to injection of the Botox in the bladder in order to reduce the overactivity of the bladder and help the patient. Does PSA level can have a role for drug choosing? The answer is, for me, no. We know that patients who have a high PSA has usually big prostate, large volume of BPH. So again, in the daily practice, no, I don't use a PSA in order to select a drug. What about urolift? Any evidence? Yes, there is. There is some study, and in the literature and in the EU guideline, there is a point concerning the prostatic lift saying that first it's interesting to improve the LUTS. There is some articles showing at the short term and 2 or 3 years follow-up of this kind of practice showing that it can improve the LUTS. And it has to be clearly evaluated in the long term. What do you think about bipolar enucleation? Oh, this is important. I mentioned that enucleation is for me the future for the treatment of BPH enlargement because clearly we have to reduce and to remove all the prostatic adenoma because it's linked with a low risk of retreatment after the surgery. I presented to you the laser approach with the OLEP. But I also mentioned that we can use it and we can do it with a green light laser, so the green light. But there is also some group who develop enucleation with a bipolar or monopolar device. And for me, it's exactly the same. The idea is to remove completely the adenoma, exactly what we did or what we do when we do an open prostatectomy. And this enucleation can be performed by any device you want. So most important is to do this enucleation. Does focal therapy as IFU has a new role in LUTS management? It was very well reported and for the moment there is no indication of using IFU for the treatment of LUTS due to BPH. Is there a study evaluating a robotic transvesical prostate enucleation versus OLEP enucleation? There is some report looking at these two approaches. And again, in terms of reduction of the symptom, in terms of improvement of the quality of life, there is the same results. So clearly we can go for OLEP or for robotic transvesical prostate enucleation. After that, I believe that using a robot for just a BPH and for something that you can do with an endoscope, it's clearly completely not relevant due to the cost of the robot. What about the increased risk of prostate cancer in patients receiving radioactive therapy? This is important. You know that when you have a patient under a 5-alpha-radioactive inhibitor, you have to follow the PSA. If you have a clear reduction of the PSA of 50 to 60%, and if the PSA continues to stay very low and no increase, there is no risk of having prostate cancer. If you have a patient with 5-alpha-radioactive inhibitor, and was an increase of the PSA, you have to be careful because sometimes you have a prostate cancer. Is there a very high risk of having risk for the patient to develop a prostate cancer and a high risk prostate cancer? The answer, when you look at the different trial publication literature, is yes, but the risk is very, very low, 0.2 point. Only in terms of difference between the group who receive placebo and the group who receive 5-alpha-reductase inhibitors for having a high risk of prostate cancer in the follow-up. So clearly the risk is very low, but it's not zero. Okay, so I'm continue with a question. We have a lot. Do you switch alpha blocker? Can we switch alpha blocker one to another? Not sure. I think we can increase the dose of the alpha blocker. For instance, doxazosine, we have a 4 milligram and 8 milligram, so we can increase the dose in order to have a better improvement of LUTS and quality of life. And this was clearly shown in the literature. You can do it. You can do it for doxazosine. You can do it for silodosine. So these two medications for which you can improve the dose. How do we manage hereditary symptoms after PVP green light? This is very important, and it's reported in the literature. There is an increased risk of having irritative symptoms after PVP. I will say 30 to 40% of your patients will have this kind of symptom after the surgery. How do we manage it? We can give alpha blocker. We can give anti-muscarinic drug. We can give anti-inflammatory drugs. It works. We have to discuss that with the patient, and of course we have to discuss that before the surgery with the patient, because it's not a low risk. It's 30 to 40% of our patients who will have this kind of irritative symptom. These irritative symptoms are more frequent at the beginning of your learning curve compared to what you are going to do after 40, 50 cases, because probably it's due to the intensity of the laser that you point on certain position of the prostate during the surgery. So you don't have to focus in one point with the laser. You really have to go clearly on the surface and not focusing in order to reduce the temperature at the point of the laser. And this is important because it can decrease this irritative syndrome after the surgery. Last question that we are going to discuss tonight, it's how to preserve the circulation when you do a TURP. There is this discussion and this point, at least in France and around Europe, I'm sure of that. There is a group who develop a certain technique of resection of the prostate, but only on the bladder neck, and they leave 1 centimeter of prostate above the verum montanum, and they said and they proved that in this case you can preserve the anterograde ejaculation. My concern is the long-term follow-up of this kind of patient, because when you have a patient who have again symptoms, especially the obstructive symptoms after a TURP, and when you do a cystoscopy, what do you find? It's a prostate that is very important at this point, just above the verum montanum. So, of course, in terms of short-term or middle-term follow-up, you will be able to say to your patient that he's going to have anterograde ejaculation, but in terms of long-term follow-up, he will probably require another TURP in order to have a good urine flow and to reduce his symptom that can develop after a couple of months or a couple of years. So I'm going to close now the webinar, this course. I hope that you enjoy the courses. I hope you enjoy the discussion that we had through the different questions that you put on the website. Have a very nice evening and hope to see you soon during our AU meeting, but also through this Euro webinar. Have a good evening. Bye-bye.